Je vous remercie et c'est un plaisir pour moi tout à fait particulier de vous accueillir ici toutes et tous. Et nous sommes particulièrement honorés d'avoir avec nous aujourd'hui Madame Maryam Rajavi. La pression sur l'Irak pour l'anéantissement du camp d'Ashraf, mais aujourd'hui plus que jamais, nous tous avec vous, nous nous dressons ici contre cette barbarie. Ashraf sera sauvé. Et nous sommes ici, comme l'a dit tout à l'heure Monsieur de Dardel, pour interpeller l'ONU, les organisations internationales diverses, les États. Nous voulons tous les mettre devant leurs responsabilités et exiger que les droits des habitants d'Ashraf soient respectés.
حالا من به ژنو آمدم، یعنی شهر حقوق بشر و سازمان ملل و سازمان‌های بین‌المللی حقوق بشری، تا اقدام‌های عاجلی را برای حفظ جان انسان‌های بیگناه و بی‌دفاع و بی‌سلاح در برابر حمله و تهدید و التیماتوم‌های خونین در همان مسیری که دبیر کل اعلام کرده است طلب کنم. بنابراین اول استقرار یک ناظر ملل متحد در اشرف برای اینکه ببیند در آنجا چه می‌گذرد. دوم باز تایید استاتوی پناهندگی سیاسی ساکنان اشرف به صورت جمعی و حتی به طور موقت توسط کمیساریای عالی پناهندگان برای برخورداری آنها از حق حفاظت بین المللی. سوم شروع بلادرنگ تحقیقات در مورد جنایت 8 آوریل، آن هم تحت نظر ملل متحد. چهارم با داشتن دولت عراق به اعلام تبعیت از فراخوان دبیر کل ملل متحد برای هر گونه استفاده از زور و خشونت و پایان دادن به محاصره ضد انسانی و شکنجه روانی و همچنین بیرون بردن افراد مسلح از داخل اشرف، جایی که در آن نزدیک به 1000 زن مسلمان به سر می‌برند. پنجم، حمایت آمریکا و اتحادیه اروپا از راه حل پارلمان اروپا برای انتقال ساکنان به کشورهای ثالث و تأمین و تضمین حفاظت آنها تا پایان این پروژه. از همه شما سپاسگزارم.
Bonjour. Bonjour. Bonjour, mesdames, messieurs. Bonjour, madame présidente. We have a situation in Camp Ashraf in Iraq where 3,400 members of the Iranian opposition are living unarmed and in great danger. And there has been a great deal of misinformation put forward by the pro-Tehran lobby in the States, which has appeared in some newspapers. Those who do not like the MEK for a variety of reasons, they have said they are a cult, and that people like General Clark, General Shelton, General Pace, General Jones, Secretary Ridge, Attorney General Mukasey, myself, and others are all taking money from the Iranian-American community and implied that their support for the residents of Ashraf has been bought. Even if that were true, and all these generals who have fought and served their country bravely, a lot more bravely, I might add, than the reporters who are writing about it, even if it were true, it has no legal effect whatsoever on the ability of the people from Ashraf to be declared refugees and to have the support of the United States and the promise of the United States in making sure that they were safe.
The fact is that there is no legal basis to classify the people in Ashraf as terrorists, and they must be taken off the list as part of the way out so that we can adopt the European plan.
Le HCR a confirmé à maintes reprises que le renvoi des résidents d'Ashraf est une violation du principe de non-refoulement. Tout le monde sait que ces personnes vivent dans un pays où le gouvernement au pouvoir les a massacrés à deux reprises. On peut donc leur poser les questions suivantes. Quelles sont les mesures à prendre par le haut-commissaire pour garantir la protection internationale des résidents d'Ashraf? En 2007, déjà, cette question vous a été posée et vous n'y avez pas répondu favorablement. Si la réponse avait été favorable, peut-être que les 47 personnes qui ont été massacrées pendant les deux précédentes attaques contre Ashraf seraient encore actuellement en vie. Si vous n'accédez pas à cette demande, vous porteriez alors une lourde responsabilité, car vous n'aurez rien fait pour offrir une protection immédiate. Vous porteriez alors une lourde responsabilité, car vous n'auriez rien fait pour offrir une protection immédiate aux résidents de cette cité et remplir ainsi votre mandat. J'aimerais aussi demander au commissaire aux droits de l'homme pourquoi le gouvernement irakien viole tous ses engagements et les conventions internationales depuis 2 ans et commet des meurtres sans aucune sanction. Pourquoi aucune mesure préventive qui fait partie du mandat du haut-commissaire n'a été prise? C'est-à-dire l'installation en permanence d'un groupe d'unamis dans le camp d'Ashraf. Nous voudrions savoir pour quelles raisons de telles décisions simples et claires sont devenues si difficiles et compliquées et qu'est-ce qu'attend le haut-commissaire aux droits de l'homme pour soutenir de telles décisions.
But there's no secret, I think, about the principles that are involved. These go to the institutional responsibilities of the United Nations, and specifically the Office of the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees. The High Commissioner for Refugees thus has a responsibility owed to the General Assembly, and I would say beyond the General Assembly, to the international community of states at large, to the peoples of the United Nations. A responsibility to provide international protection to refugees, which is to say, to use international law, international obligations, and of course the conscience of humanity to ensure that lives and human rights are guaranteed and solutions found. What then holds the UNHCR back? Are the residents of Ashraf refugees? Can we ever seriously doubt that they are? Even a cursory look at the facts confirms their fear of persecution on political grounds, that it is well founded, and that the present regime in Iran is determined to persecute them unto death. Must every case be considered individually? No. Though we are used to individual case-by-case determinations in the asylum systems of the developed world, it's not always or by any means necessary. It's certainly not required by the UNHCR mandate or even by the 1951 Convention.
If Iraq is not willing, and it is very clear that they are not willing, in fact, they are against protecting the people in Ashraf, if the people of Ashraf cannot return to Iran without endangering their lives, then there is only one option, and that is the option of international protection. Now, I'm not going to go into the law of it, because Mr. Guy Goodwin-Gill has done that very clearly. The law does not prevent, international law does not prevent UNHCR. In fact, it positively encourages UNHCR to provide protection to the residents of Camp Ashraf. There is no barrier from the perspective of being former combatants, even if some of them were, or from the political opinion that they hold. Protection cannot be conditional. The history of UNHCR's mandate is a history of flexibility. UNHCR has, on many occasions in its 60 years of history, stretched its mandate interpreted it in a manner in which it has allowed the United Nations to provide protection to people in need. So why isn't it doing that now? So my plea is that UNHCR has to take a look at the humanitarian situation on the ground. UNHCR did not hesitate to aid 10 million refugees who came out of my country in 1971. I'm talking of Bangladesh. So here we have 3,600 people. That is not an enormous burden. It is, in fact, an obligation on the part of UNHCR. So what needs to be done? I think we have all said it, but let me repeat it again. First and foremost, immediate protection to the people where they are. And that responsibility rests with the UN High Commissioner for Refugees. Yes, it is important that it be done in coordination and cooperation with the United Nations, but the responsibility is a distinct, clear, and independent responsibility of the High Commissioner. And my question is to the UN High Commissioner for Refugees, to the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights, to the United Nations UNAMI operation, and to the governments, European and the US government, are you going to wait or are you going to move and do something about it? Thank you.